It is time for us to get started. We are very glad that you are here. We have a lot of folks that are not here. Our sick list just grows and grows and grows. But we do have some folks that are here that are feeling better, and we're very thankful for that. Brendan Jones still taking treatments, cancer treatments. He's having a hard time eating. But we do have his address now. It's on the board. If you want to get that address and send him a card. Nancy Marler is still in life care, but she spent the day in the emergency room today having a lot of problems being mixed up, and I think it's a lot of the medicine and stuff that they're getting her, but she is back at life care now. Janelle Davis, talking to the doctor about radiation or the extent of that, so we'll find out later. Nancy Sharp, I think, is feeling better. Son and Shirley are here. They're feeling better. Bobby Doss, as we mentioned, is back in Memorial. He's going to have a biopsy on his kidneys tomorrow, and they're doing dialysis now. They did it yesterday and today, and that has helped a lot. But if you know much about dialysis, that can also cause some other issues, but that's where he's at. Jimmy Milliron's feeling better. Steven's better. He's here. Carolyn Robertson, not feeling well. Little Eva has got a fever, and Sarah is wearing a boot on one foot. The only healthy one in the bunch is Pat, and he's got the prayer. Jenny Stooksbury is now traveling back and forth, so she's at home, goes back each Tuesday, trip down and back, but having a real trouble eating as well, but I guess doing fairly well. Tonight does begin our spring series. Jesse Nelson's with us. Matthew will give an introduction to Jesse here in a few minutes, but he will be doing our invitation devotional in a moment. Next week, Dennis Smith is our speaker. So for the next 2-3 months, we'll have a different speaker each Wednesday night, and I think that it's going to be a real blessing to us. Parents Night Out is coming up on Friday from 5 to 8. You can talk to Matthew about that. The young adults have a bowling trip Sunday evening, so you can keep that in your mind as well. I think that's everything.
It's a proper time. The invitation song will be 871. 871, we'll sing the first, second, and fourth verse. Before we have our prayer and our devo, we'll sing number 54, first, second, and fourth verse of number 54.
Oh. Pray with me, please. Our Father, our Lord, our God, who art in heaven, we humbly come before thee tonight with hearts of thanksgiving, thanking thee for the rains you have given, the sunshine that warms us, this great land of opportunity in which we have to live with the abundance of it. Father, we are truly grateful for everything you give us. Help us, Father, to not allow our blessings to hide the light of your word in our lives. Give us the strength to go out and to teach others, not just once in a while, but let us make it a habit to be with those who need thy word and to be willing to teach it each and every day. Father, we thank thee for the ministering servants, Brother Nelson, Brother Matthew, Brother Steve, all of our teachers, not only here at Dayton, but throughout the world, as they each labor to bring us lessons from thy word that we may teach others and lead others to the safety of the church, which will lead them to home in heaven. Father, we pray for the many that are listed as sick and afflicted. We ask thee to give them strength, Father, if it is in accordance to thy divine plans, that they may once again have a walk of life that they so desire, and to be able to praise thee and to worship thee in truth and in spirit. Give us strength, Father, each and every day. Forgive us of the sins that we are willing to repent of. In the name of thy blessed Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Earlier today, I was watching a video on the release of the first iPhone. And it was just him showing the features of what this iPhone, you know, this new technology, this new smartphone is going to bring into the world. You know, one of the first things that he brings up? The fact that you can put it in your pocket and not accidentally turn it on because there is a slide your finger button. Remember on the old iPhones, you slid your finger to open up the smart device, and people were cheering in the audience. They were so excited about it. And then he was trying to show them that if you wanted to move anything or search anything, you just used your finger, and people were absolutely mind blown. And I think about that now with all the things that our iPhones can do. If my iPhone acted like the first iPhone, I'd probably be pretty upset. It's too slow. It ain't smart enough for me, right? And we live in such a fast-paced world that technology, as it grows, things that used to excite us, things that new technology, new apps, new features used to get us really excited, now they're just their old hat. And, you know, I was thinking about that in, like, the church at Ephesus in Revelation, right? One of the things that is said about them is that they lost their first love. They abandoned their first love, some translations say. And, you know, whatever that may be, I tend to fall into the category where at first they did all these things out of excitement for Jesus, a love for Jesus, right? They stood for truth because it's what Jesus did, right? They got rid of false teachers because Jesus is the way, the truth, and life. No man comes to the Father except through him. So if there's a false teaching going on, right, it's not that we want to tear a brother down or tear somebody down. It's the fact that we want people to know Christ, and we want people to know the truth and the way and the life, right? Because we want people to get to the Father. Well, unfortunately, sometimes what can happen is we can get so giddy about truth, and we get so giddy about, you know, getting rid of false teachers. We get so giddy about defending the faith. It becomes more of an attack of the person because we fall in love with defending the faith rather than falling in love with Jesus. And I think that's separate, right? I think that's different. And we can get really hooked on church and love church and forget why we are here. One of the reasons I love church, I love to see people's faces. I think we're a family. I think we're a community. I think we are common believers who have common faith, who have common goals, and are looking to go to the same place. We get to come together, and the world doesn't have that. It's not there. And so I can get hooked on the idea of church because this is a family. And yeah, if I lose Jesus, even along the way, I may love to come and see my brother and sister in Christ, but why am I really here? I'm really here because of my love for Jesus. Because if you weren't here, would I still be here? Right? And that's one of the dangers we can possess by the church offering so many programs and things. Come here because we have this. Come here because we have that. Come here because we do this and X, Y, and Z. And we're having to constantly come up with new things to attract new people. And I'm not against that necessarily. But if people aren't here because they love Jesus, then we've created a false hope and a false understanding. I don't want to just give people a place to belong. I want to give people a place of purpose, of love of the Father, right, and community with the Father. And so, you know, as we go about life, though, I want you to think about the time that you gave your life to Christ. The time when your sins were washed away, when you come up out of those waters of baptism, and how you felt. And remember, a lot of, maybe I'm different, but I made a lot of commitments. I'm not going to swear anymore, right? I'm not going to watch bad videos anymore. You know, as a young kid, that was my big, right, no more swearing, no more bad movies, no more bad music. And I did really good for a while. But what happens after a while? That passion, that zeal, that love, it kind of dwindles, doesn't it? And so things that used to excite me, you know, bring your life to Jesus. Yeah, that got me excited at one time, but what excites me now? And so I think we need to constantly go back to why are we here? And what are we doing? Who are we here for? If we do anything that is not out of love for Christ and love for Jesus and love for God, then anything we do, whether good or bad, it's meaningless. And just like that, you know, watching that video of people being excited about features that we, if that's the only features iPhones brought out today, we'd be upset. When it was first introduced into the world, they were excited about it. And then I think about when Jesus was brought into the world. Right? When his birth was announced, what did people do? What did the angels do? They rejoice. What did the shepherds do? They rejoice. What did the prophets do? They rejoiced, right? They looked forward to this day. And then I think about in Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost, when those same group of Jews who yelled, "Crucify him, crucify him, crucify him," heard that their words and their actions is what put Jesus on the cross. And they were heartbroken. And they said, "What do we need to do? What shall we do?" But there was hope. You see, even though they had sin, and even though that sin put Jesus on the cross, Jesus offers redemption. Jesus offers hope. He offers eternal life through him. And I can't imagine how they felt when they heard that there was a solution to their problem. They put the Lord and Savior on the cross, and yet Jesus loved them so much, it was in his plan that he died for them and saved even the people who yelled, "Crucify him, crucify him, crucify him." This world can be real busy. It can get us really distracted. And church can just be, "Oh, I got to get to church tonight. Oh, I got to get to Bible class." There's a really good speaker coming to speak at Summer Spring Series, right? Got to go listen to him. It means nothing without a love of Jesus. And I think we need to constantly go back and remind ourselves how we felt when we gave our lives to Christ, he became our Lord, and we surrendered all things to him. And when we do that, we'll find joy and peace and hope. So tonight, I want to offer an invitation. If you're not a Christian, right, if you've not given your life to Christ, if you've not had your sins washed away in baptism by contacting the blood of Jesus, you can't have true joy. You can't have the joy that we're talking about yet. But you can. No matter what you've done, no matter what sins you've committed, Jesus' blood is greater than your sin. Grace is greater than sin. The Bible teaches us that. And so what prevents you tonight? But maybe you're a Christian and you forgot what it felt like to have all of your sins removed and taken care of. Go back and remember and think about that day. And think about the commitments you made to yourself. And go back to your first works. Love Christ and do all things out of love. If there's anything that you need this evening, we ask that you come forward as we stand together and sing.
Be seated.
This time we'll dismiss our teachers to their classes. And our kids to their classes. The middle and high school group will stay out here. Today we're beginning the spring series that we've been talking about for the past month or so. The spring series is titled "For Such a Time as This," and so we're going to be looking at several cultural issues that are the church needs to address. And I think for many of these issues that we see in our culture and in the church, the solution to those issues are Christians who act like Christians should. Tonight we have Jesse Nelson, who's going to speak to us. Jesse is the preacher for the Lenore City Church of Christ, just up the road. He is married to his wife Ashley. They have three kids that are entirely too old. I knew them when they were little, and it's hard to believe how much they've grown up. He is a student at the East Tennessee School of Preaching, now the Southeast Institute of Biblical Studies. He graduated in 2012, is that right? Yeah. 2012. And so he was there when we first moved to Knoxville. And I remember him, I think he taught one of my middle school classes when I was there. And so he and Tom Bowling were classmates, and so we got a lot of connections there. Jesse's going to be speaking to us about a culture that's seeking authenticity.
Is that the remote
control? Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Down is 4.
Okay. Yeah, we're a little backwards here. It's all right. I do want to, before I begin, say thank you for the invite. I appreciate Matthew very much. Appreciate his family. Like I said, I thought they had been there for many years at Carnes because of how much the Carnes Church just loved the Higginbothams. And so I didn't realize we were kind of there at the same time. Obviously, you got Tom and Summer Bowling, who were some of my favorite people when I was in school. Tom already told me, he's like, I'm glad you've made it because no one thought you did. So, right? But I'm here, and we're talking about a culture seeking authenticity. You know, I'm from the North, okay? So my upbringing, my background, my childhood is a little bit different maybe than yours, but also probably very similar. Because even though I'm from New York, I'm not from that New York, right? We wore T-shirts that says, I'm from New York, not from this New York. And it pointed at New York City. Never been in the city, grew up on a farm. But North is a little bit different, especially in a religious context. Grew up with a lot of Catholics. Grew up with a lot of friends who were religious but never went to church. And so that was kind of the way I lived my life. You know, I was a hockey player before I was a Christian. And if you were to ask me if I was a Christian, yeah, but I'm a hockey player first. And so you got to ask yourself, how real can something be when you put something else first? Right? I had T-shirts that said, eat, sleep, breathe, hockey. Right? So my authentic self was a hockey player. Even though I tried to claim Christianity through my life and actions, I don't know how well I could have done that. Well, we live in a world, and I've got a lot of kids my age who I went to school with who are into a lot of the getting into politics now, right? I'm 33 years old, and so we know everything there is to know under the sun, right? At 33, that's when you start knowing things. And so I see a lot of stuff on Facebook. I see a lot of stuff on Instagram. That kind of disappoints me. Friends who I loved and cherished who, you know, are teaching things that are just, they're kind of out there, right? And the big push today is this idea of authenticity, right? Authenticity. And it sounds good, right? Don't you want anything you do to be authentic, right? You don't want to be a fake person, right? You don't want to be somebody who says one thing and does another, right? But in today's world, authenticity, there's this big push to be your true self, okay? And what they mean by that is you need to search kind of your inner thoughts and the things that come to your mind when you think about yourself. There's actually an entire exercise. I don't know if I'm on or not. I think I am. There's actually an entire exercise they teach you to do. You get off social media for several weeks. You get away from friends and family. And you go off by yourself from somewhere and you just think about you, right? You just think about yourself. Who you kind of maybe identify as, right? There's a lot of identity stuff going on in the world today. Think about the things that you want and you desire. And when you come back, don't let anybody tell you different than who your true self is. And I'm going to be a little dramatic here. But what if I went away, okay? And let's say I live a pretty rough upbringing, and I've got a lot of people in my life who I kind of dislike, don't like, and I go away and I say, you know what? My true self is going to be, and this is a little dramatic, I understand, I'm a serial killer. Think about that. Like, what if I believe that there are people in my life and there are people in other people's life that if they just were removed from this world, it would be a better place. My life would be better, right? Do you know people in your life who, if they were, like, if there was a delete button, your life would probably be a better life, right? Maybe that or that boss, right? Or fellow church member, I don't know. You know, you never know, right? But what if I identify? What if that was my true self? Would that be acceptable in today's world? You see, Adolf Hitler believe that his true self and his divine purpose was to remove people who did not look a certain way, didn't have a certain color hair, right? Didn't have a certain color eyes, though he didn't fit that bill. And he believed he was on a divine mission. He was living out what I would say was his true self. So what happens when your true self is not a healthy self? What if it's not good for you? What if you think negative thoughts? What if you have thoughts about yourself that are not good? Then how can I
Let's say I'm trying to help you as a friend, and you're living out your true self. How can I be of assistance to you if your truth is your truth and my truth is my truth, right? And you're authentic. You're living out your authentic life. And so another phrase that goes around is sincerity equals authenticity, right? Have you heard that before? Being sincere about something, right? As long as you are sincerely doing it, then it's the right thing to do. If you believe it, you do it with all of your heart. Give all of your passion towards something, which I think is great, by the way. If you're going to do something, how should you do it? You should do it with all your heart, right? It's kind of biblical, right? When you're to love God, how do you love God? With all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, all your mind. But do you know of somebody in Scripture who said that they were sincere about loving God, but they missed the mark when it came to knowledge? Didn't Paul say that? Right? Paul says, I lived a blameless life. My conscience, it was clear. It was clean. And the way in which I was living and doing religion and serving God and loving God, I was sincere. Paul would write in Romans chapter 10 about his Jewish brothers, that they have a zeal of God. And that word zeal is an overwhelming passion, by the way. That word is an overwhelming passion. Jews loved God. They loved their tradition. They loved being a Jew. They loved going through all of their, you know, hedge Torah laws, especially some of those Pharisees and Sadducees, right? They loved the way they did religion. And you know what? People believed it. They bought into it. People would look at a Pharisee and say, that's a righteous man. They would look at a Sadducee, that's a righteous man. So much so that if you were to invite a Pharisee over to your house, guess what spot on the table you'd give him? You'd give him the head spot. Because he was a rabbi. He was a teacher. He knew. But Paul would say they have a zeal to God, but not according to knowledge. And so what I want to do tonight is, you know, if you believe that you were created by Jesus, right? All of us hopefully here believe that we were created by God. And God is the one who has formed us, right, and molded us and makes us, and he made us in his image, which means that we are his image bearers, then do you think God knows a little bit about who we ought to be? Who we ought to be? My son, Benjamin, he's a little wild man. He wants to be an astronaut. And he, one time he did, and he bought all these books, he bought all this stuff that he wanted to do, and he wanted to live in space. His teacher told him at one time that, you know, they're trying to colonize Mars. And so he thought it'd be the coolest thing in the world to go live on Mars. And that's what he wanted to do. My other daughter, Olivia, bless her heart, she is the girl's girl. Like, if there is a little princess, right, that you can think of, dressing in all the dresses, right? Girl, she wants to be a princess. She wants to be a fairy tale princess. That's what she wants to do. She plays princess. She plays fairy tale stuff. That or mom. Now, Leah, my 12-year-old, she don't know what she wants anymore. She's in that stage, right? What do you want to do? I don't know. Who do you want to be? I don't know. What do you want to go to college? I don't know. What do you want to do? What do you want to eat tonight? I don't know. I don't care. She does care, because when you actually feed her, guess what she does? I don't want that. I don't want that. You said you didn't care. Well, I do care. I don't care as long as it's something that I like, right? So they kind of go through these stages. And as parents, what is our job to do? Help guide them through those stages of life, because they don't know who they are. And so if you sometimes you just left people by themselves, you get kind of what you get out in the world, right? Go visit a college, my oldest. I have four, by the way. I do have three biological children. I have a fourth who we adopted at 10. She's going to be 17, teaching her to drive, trying to get her license. And she had to go visit a college. I won't say which one. And she come back and says, Dad, I saw one of the strangest things I've ever seen. I said, what is it? She says, out in the common, there was like a common yard area in between the college campus. There were these two girls who were dressed up like cats, and they were purring and meowing and basically licking each other. They identify as cats. And so we got to ask ourselves, okay, and I'm not trying to get into identity politics, I'm not trying to get into all that stuff. We got to ask ourselves, is it really healthy to tell somebody to be their true self? Because if they don't think healthy thoughts about themselves, then what are we to do? You know what the second greatest command is? To love your neighbor as yourself. So you have to have a pretty good idea of who you are, right? And how to love yourself before you can truly learn to love others. And I think that's one of our problems with why we struggle with love, because we still struggle with loving ourselves. We still struggle with who we are. Well, Jesus, on the Sermon on the Mount, he concludes probably one of the greatest sermons that have ever been preached with a lesson on authenticity, which he starts off that sermon, remember, about the Beatitudes. Blessed are you who are meek. Blessed are you who are humble. Blessed are you who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, right? He goes through all the Beatitudes. He talks about how our righteousness needs to be greater than that of the Pharisees. You have heard something, but I... If you go and pray, pray in secret. If you give, give in secret. If you fast, don't let people know, right? He's trying to get you to understand who you are. And he ends this sermon in a very peculiar way. And it's a way Scripture does at the end of either an era or a sermon. Moses does this often. He presents two options in life. And when you really break down life, there's two options. There's life and there's death, isn't there? There's life and death. There are things that will bring you closer to eternal life and your home in heaven with God, and closer to the Father, or there are things that bring you away from God. There is no neutral ground when it comes to God. You can't say, well, I'm just not going to pick. You either choose life or you choose death. And that's what Jesus is about to present. So turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. Let's look at verse 12 through 14. And as I read this, I want you to think about something. Everyone's on a journey to somewhere, aren't they? Everyone's on a journey. And in that journey, you are leading the life and going on the road of what you believe to be true. Isn't that true? Right? If you think work is the epitome of what a man should do. Let's talk about men for a minute. There are some men who think, what my responsibility is, and my only responsibility is to work and to provide. So guess what they do? When extra shifts come up, guess who's taking it? When long hours come, guess who's taking it, right? And so work kind of becomes who they are, sometimes out of necessity, right, to provide for their families. But it's taken on this identity. And so what Jesus is going to say, watch. He says, so whatever you wish that others would do to you, do also to them, for this is the law and prophets. Enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. This is probably one of the most unpopular teachings of Jesus that there is. Let's be honest. You don't hear this being talked around in circles a whole lot. You'll hear God, for God's son, that he gave his only unique son, right? That whoever believed, John 3:16, love your neighbor, right? You'll hear that a lot. Jesus is about love, right? How many of you watched the Super Bowl, right? Saw all the commercials of the serving and washing of feet, right? Jesus washed feet. That's a huge thing that Jesus did, and so that's one of the major teachings. Jesus' teaching comes down to love and to service and to just be kind, right? And there's an aspect of Jesus that's emphasized and magnified in the religious world. And yet Jesus gives us a truth here. That there are, and by the way, he's going to be talking to religious people. He's not even talking about Christian versus non-Christian. He's going to start grouping those who claim to be followers of Jesus. And in that group of Christians, there is a narrow way, if your versions may say straight. The King James Version, I kind of like it. It's not straight as in like a straight path. It's straight as in straight jacket. Something that is constrained. Something, it's almost as if you're going down the road and you are compressed, okay? And so this road, there is pressure. It's so small, you almost have to compress yourself to walk it, okay? And so there's this narrow way. And then there is this wide way. And he says it leads where? It leads to destruction. Now that can mean a lot of things, right? Just because Jesus said that, well, what does that mean? What does the narrow way look like? And a lot of people have tried to define what that narrow way is. But what I want to bring up, the point I want to talk about, is if everybody is going about their true self, if everybody is about going about their own truth and their authentic life, that seems to be going against the teachings of Jesus here, doesn't it? That it's not about you becoming your true self. It's about you figuring out what it takes and what road leads me to the Father. And no matter what I got to do, whether that's sacrificing some things that I like, whether that's sacrificing some attributes about myself, becoming less of myself, so that I can find this path and walk it, am I willing to do it? And Jesus is going to tell us, not everybody's willing. Not everybody's willing. And these are people who are claiming to become Christians. Now, I'm going to be careful with my words here, because a lot of times in our fellowship and in the churches of Christ, we begin to think Church of Christ narrow, everybody else wide. I want us to bring that even closer to home. Let's look in this church building right here. All right? Start analyzing your own life. Are there people who claim to be a part of the way who are still struggling with fully committing their lives to Jesus? Aren't they? All right, isn't that why we have repentance? Because people are struggling with it? Isn't that why you have shepherds and elders who are looking out for the flock when they see somebody who's straying? What do? They try to guide them back onto the path because they're walking away. So it's very easy for us to become very highly and exalted on passages like these, and we generalize everybody among the churches of Christ. We're on the narrow way, and everybody else is on the... He's talking about people who think they're on the narrow, who think they're doing right, who think they're following Jesus. That includes us. We have to analyze, what path are we on? I want you to stop trying to always see ourselves in good light when you read Scripture. You know, when you read the story of the Pharisee and the publican, who do you identify with? Think about it. Who are you supposed to identify with in that scripture? Everybody would love to be the publican, wouldn't we? Oh, I'm not looking at everybody else and judging how they're doing religion. I'm just concerned about my own sin. Really? Is that who we identify as? Or can we be a little too much of the Pharisee on that aspect and look at everybody else and compare our righteousness based upon what we are doing better than the other people? Well, at least I'm not like that guy. At least I'm doing a little better than so-and-so. And we start naming all the things that we have done, and we tell God, I'm one of your righteous, I'm one of the good, right? Because of look what I do for you. Acknowledge me, God, because of what I'm doing for you. And I want us to start thinking about ourselves as, what really is Jesus talking about? Because he's not going to end this lesson here, right? This doesn't end here, okay? It's going to continue. All right, so we're going to look at some implications of what Jesus just said. First, you cannot trust every teaching you hear. Can you? It can't be everybody's right. Can't be. So this idea of authenticity and your true self and sincerity can't be, you can be sincere and be wrong. You can be sincere and be wrong. You know what that also tells us? We need to give grace to those who are wrong. Because a lot of times we look at everybody else and we look at all the things they've got wrong and we're like, they just so stupid, right? You got to be stupid not to see baptism. Have you ever heard that? You ever said that? You ever thought that? Right? Never, right? Never. Good. Good. Yep. Yeah. Well, we got a problem everywhere I go, and this is not unique. Yeah. Yeah. Should I keep going then? Just keep going at them? Well, and here's the thing. Here's what we got to realize. This is all of us. We've all been there. Right? I remember talking to my dad one time. And my dad was kind of always an on and off Christian. Okay? Growing up in my life, on and off Christian. Played a lot of hockey. If there was a hockey game or a church service, guess what I went to? Went to the hockey game. Well, guess who led me there? Guess who was my coach? My dad. And when I started going to preaching school, my dad actually started reading his Bible because, one, I came home and he started realizing that I knew more Bible than he did. And so guess what? He was not going to be done. He was not going to be outdone by me. So I'd come home. We were, come home from summertime or during a long break, and we'd stay up till 3 in the morning, go back and forth. And I remember about a year after that, my dad's like, I just can't believe those people who don't put their noses in their Bible and read and don't know what I know. And I looked at my dad, I said, Dad, that was you a year ago. Until I went to preaching school and started challenging you, that's when you, which is a good thing, I'm not saying that's bad, but we can't, we're on this journey and we get to here and we look down on who's further behind in our opinion than us. I want us to be a little more introspective, okay? More personal with this. Let's judge ourselves, all right? Okay, so I went a little further ahead of myself. Secondly, you can't trust every teaching you hear, right? Second, your decisions in life reveal your path. You can tell me all day long that you love God. But if I don't see it and I don't feel it, it's not true. It's not true. Right? I won't go into that story. Anyone heard of Pascal's wager? So Pascal's wager, he has this thing that he tells atheists because, atheists, they're one of their things, I have a hard time believing in God. Which, if you don't have a supernatural mind, right? You believe that everything that you see is all that exists. Isn't it hard to think about that there is a being out there that is beyond the physical? If you're just, like, if you haven't been taught, it can be difficult, right? It's even, I'm doing this class on angels and demons and all these types of things. People are like, I have a hard time believing in this. Why? Because we're in that Western mindset where if I can't put it through the scientific experiment, right, can't see it, touch it, taste it, smell it, examine it, we have a hard time believing it. Pascal's wager has this, he has this proposition he tells the atheist. He goes, okay, right, you say that I live by faith, and a lot of times when people say faith, they're talking about like this blind faith, right? They're talking about something that you can't really prove or test. And so you heard this story, you heard this tale, and you're just kind of believing in it. And obviously faith is more than that. And his big thing is, well, you have to have faith as well. You live by faith too. The atheist lives by faith. You want to know why? Because if somebody presents in the world, and there's a lot of people presenting in the world that there is a God, you have to have faith that there's not. Think about that. You have to believe, faith is belief, you have to believe that there is no God. And Pascal says, if you are going to take the position that there is no God, because if there is a God, that means there's a heaven and hell, right? If there is a God, there's a heaven and hell. If there is no God, that's of no consequence. But if there is, you better be convinced fully. You have better examine the evidence before you make that decision, because the consequences of unbelief are great. It's a huge cost, the consequences of unbelief. And we have to convince people of that. But our decisions in our life, and this goes back to what I was saying earlier, reveal really what we believe. Okay? Are you a forgiving person? Ask, you know, are you a forgiving person? So when someone comes up and hurts you personally and attacks you, and they say, I'm sorry, that's what determines if you're a forgiving person. Once again, I don't want to hear it. Jesus wants to see it. Because how do you judge a tree, he says? You judge a tree by its fruit. It can claim to be something all day long, but we need to see it. And if we, and this is where we're going to start getting real, real into it. If we claim to be followers of Jesus, guess who we need to start living like? We need to start living like Jesus. If we claim to have this truth of Christ, and we talk a lot about in Christ, in Christ, in Christ, in Christ, right? If we claim it, let's look like the man that we are following. Let's look like him. Let's act like him. Let's think like him. Let's treat others the way that he treated. That's the implications of what it means to be an authentic Christian. Well, that's intolerant of you, Jesse, to say there's a narrow way. I didn't say it. Well, it's intolerant of Jesus. And a lot of people believe Jesus and God are intolerant because they created a world, right? They created this world knowing a whole lot of people would reject him, and Jesus is sending people to hell. First of all, the Bible doesn't teach that Jesus sends people to hell. Our sins sends us to hell, right? There's just a place, there's got to be a place where the people who don't choose God go. And it was created initially for Satan and his angels. God desires all men to be what? To be saved. And so just because Jesus is stating a fact does not make him intolerant, because Jesus does not like that fact. He's not a fan that the way is narrow, right? He's not a fan that few will find it. This is what he desires. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened. And I, Jesus, as I will imagine, Jesus, God in the flesh, he walked this earth for 3.5 years. And he went around to people and said, I got what you need. Remember the story of the Good Samaritan? Or not the Good Samaritan. Remember the story of the Samaritan woman at the well? Remember his statement? If you knew who I was, you would be asking me for water. And part of what we really want to give to people is, if you really knew the truth, get rid of what people say about Jesus and what people say about God. I want to teach you the real Jesus. And if you knew him, you've got a chance of following him. But unfortunately, sometimes, kind of like what Gandhi said, well, it's quoted, Gandhi is said to have said this, I really love your Jesus, but I really don't like those who follow him. That's paraphrasing. Meaning, the teachings of Jesus and the life of Jesus, he's like, I could follow that guy, but those who claim to follow him, they look nothing like him. They act nothing like him. And so we don't want to be a barrier, right, to the world around us. That's what it means to live an authentic Christian life. It means to give up self, right? Give up self. All right. So how do we spot a fake versus a true? Let's go down to verse 21 of Matthew 7. Because this is difficult. This is difficult right here. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, do we not prophesy in your name, cast out demons in your name, and do many mighty works in your name? So far, I've got a problem. I've got a problem. How do I identify this man as being someone who Jesus will say later, I never knew you? Because he's doing the works of Jesus. This isn't an atheist. This isn't a person who doesn't claim to believe God. This is a person who's trying to serve God. You see, a lot of times a fake and a real Christian look very similar. Both of them probably go to church, don't they? I mean, if a person stopped going to church, they've outed themselves really quick. They probably don't believe, though. But they both believe in Jesus. He's going to say they're both emotionally involved with faith. Lord, Lord, you know what, Lord, you know when you said something twice? When you said something twice in Scripture, it was with passion. When David found out Absalom, oh, Absalom, Absalom. Jesus, when he said, oh, Martha, Martha. And after he'd done, he looked out over Jerusalem. He said, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how I tried to gather you as a hen gathers, right? His chicks under my wings. This was a statement you would make of passion and love and zeal. This is the person who said, Lord, Lord, I thought what I was doing was right. I was emotionally involved. I had my heart in it. I was sincere. And I was doing what I thought to be your works. And he says both are active in service. They're both doing the will, what they believe to be the will of the Father. And so how do you spot them? The difference comes in Matthew 7:24. You see, it says, everyone who then hears these words of mine and does them will be... Tell me when I've got... How much time do I have left? 8 minutes? Okay. Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. Everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. The rain fell and the floods came, the winds blew, beat against the house and it fell. And great was its fall. Question is, what are the works that he's talking about? Because the man who just came up to him believed he was doing them. What works? Is he bringing up doctrine? Is he bringing up worship right now? Is that under consideration of what Jesus is saying? Or is he talking about the sermon that he just preached about the Beatitudes, of being a light into the world, about having our righteousness being that greater than the Pharisees, right? About examining our heart. You don't just commit adultery, right? You also commit adultery. Where does it start? It starts in your heart. When you steal, where does it start? It starts here. Where does murder start? It starts from hate, right? Remove all of these sins from our heart. And then he throws in the end of Matthew chapter 5. Verse 43, you have heard it said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Ouch. Love your enemies. We live right now in a political and cultural world of absolutely hating the enemy. We hate the opposition. We hate those, and it's not one-sided, by the way. This isn't a one-sided thing. We hate one another. There are YouTube clips after YouTube clips after people standing on the street arguing and fighting, getting into fist fights, killing each other over differences of opinion, differences in political alignment, differences in sometimes even theological alignment. We have learned and have been raised to hate those who are not like us. And it is okay because we are standing for the truth. And this goes back to my invitation. Revelation, that church was standing for the truth, but they lost something in doing it. They lost their first love. He says, so the wise man has built his house upon whom? Upon Jesus. What does that mean? If you are going to get into heaven one day, who is going to be the reason why you get there? Jesus. If your foundation is built upon all the things that you've done and you show up to God with a list, a scroll, and say, God, look what I've done for you. I deserve to be here. You have built your house on sand. Because if you want to weigh out sins versus, you know, you're right from wrong, you're good from bad, guess which one's going to win every time outside of Christ? One sin. If that maybe you're just that one person who's going to, that one sin. Where are you deserving? The penalty of sin is what? Death. I don't care what sin it was. I don't care how bad it was. I don't care how often you did it. It will send you to hell. Only Jesus can save you from your sins. Isn't that what Paul says in Romans 7? Oh, wretched man that I am, who can save me from this? But there's no condemnation, Romans 8:1, for those who are really good. Perfect attendance Sunday morning, right? Give more than the rest. Those who are in Christ. Now that looks like a certain life, right? And we're not here to discuss all those things. But our faith is founded in Jesus. Our foundation is Jesus. And if we are built on anything else, we may look religious. Our house may look just like the house that is built on the foundation. But when the storms come, what's going to happen to that house? It will fail. And so, here's what it looks like. First, Jesus says, go back to Matthew chapter 7, verse 23. He says, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Why are they doing what they're doing? You know there are a lot of people who use Jesus for their own benefit? Do you know there are a lot of preachers who preach for the wrong reasons? That was happening during Paul's time, wasn't it? Preach for a paycheck, preach for money, right? There are people who use Jesus as a brand to sell stuff and to get famous, and right? If you're using Jesus for you, it's your will, not God's will. So God's will over their own will. They put others above themselves. That's a test. That's a test that I do. When I'm looking at somebody and I'm analyzing their spirituality, throw them in the midst of a business meeting in the church and figure out, are they here to get their way every time and every time? That's a person who's in it for themselves. Or are they constantly putting other people's needs and other people's wants and other people's desires above themselves? It's a person who's willing to die to self. My favorite people in all this world, if I were to mention their names, they'd be mad at me because they want no recognition whatsoever. I love Lenore City Church of Christ because we are probably, in my experience, a church that is an anonymous giver more than anybody I've ever met. People who have given big dollars to people sitting right next to them and they never want anybody to know. I've been the recipient of that. There are people who have helped me out of sticky situations. I want to know their name so I can thank them. They don't want it. They just want to serve. It's not about them. It's about God. Finally, the loving your enemy is the test. All right, I'm going to finish with these last three scriptures, okay? Because I want to bring it back to authentic. The Bible does call us to be authentic, and it uses the word genuine in the ESV. Genuine is what it means to be authentic. To be genuine. Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Let love be genuine, though. And he goes on and he lists a bunch of things in Romans 12. I challenge you tonight to go read it. And it's all about how we treat one another. 1 Corinthians 8:8, when Paul's encouraging the church at Corinth to give, because guess what they did? They decided, we're going to give all this money to Jerusalem, and it's going to be a big sum. And they seem to be a little braggadocious about it. Guess what they still haven't given? They still haven't given it. And so they were all show and flash, and they had no follow through. And so Paul's trying to encourage them by bringing up the example of the Macedonian church, who was poor and didn't have a whole lot and yet gave above their means because they first gave of themselves. He says this, I say this not as a command, because if I begin to command you and force you to live Christianity and force you to follow through with your commitment in following Jesus, it's not genuine anymore, isn't it? You're just doing it because I made you and I forced you and I guilt you. Paul says, prove by the earnestness of others that your love is also genuine. Just give the gift you said you would give. and do it out of love. And then 1 Peter chapter 3, we're going to end reading this. Go ahead, if you have your Bibles, go to 1 Peter chapter 3, and here's where we're going to end. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. It says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to His great mercy, He caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed at the last time." Right? Jesus is the reason why we are going to be saved. He's in heaven. He's living. Our faith is sure. But guess what's happening to us while we are here on earth? Here's what he's going to say. "In this you rejoice now for a little while, if necessary. You have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes." You want to know the last test that I give myself? Besides loving my enemies, besides following through my commitments, besides loving that which is good, when things are going wrong in my life, when I'm being tested, persecuted, things aren't going, prayers don't seem to be answered, and life seems to be just coming down on me, where is my faith? Where's my trust in God? It's easy to trust in God when things are going good. That's what a fake Christian does. Things are going well, prayers answered, praise be to God. Things aren't going well, where are you, God? Why, God? You've abandoned me, God. And so let love be genuine. Thank you. I hope you guys have a good night.